there, guys. If you stick to the wall, please keep falling. And as you go past, we'll tell you what you've seen under the glass floor. As I said, stick to the wood there, keep falling around, we'll tell you what you've seen under the glass floor.
You've got to stick to the
word
of the man.
So if you keep going around, yeah, I'll see you.
Yeah.
So as you go around, you walk around an exact replica of the archaeological dig we had here between 1976 and 1981. The photos you see in the wall, that's exactly where you're stood now. We found 4 houses, 18 workshops and 40,000 artifacts. Now we've seen the glass floor as a replica. We can't show you the real archaeology because it's very cafe near us is built on top of it. So if you go for a coffee, saddle or all this. Now I'm actually inside a Viking house, one wall which is just here, the back wall is just here, back plank was your back doorstep, all you guys here on the garden path, the turnout cage is here, and the front door is right about where the lift is. It's 7 metres long, 4 metres wide, it's got one room with 12 people living inside. So you've really got to like each other, don't you? It's incredibly cramped inside a Viking house. Now we actually know what the Vikings themselves look like as well, because we found their skeletons. We have taken their skulls and forensically rebuilt their faces. So when you're on the ride, you have the lady across the road and one of the fishermen, they're both real Vikings. We also know exactly what they're eating, because I'm afraid they're just in the middle of a Viking toilet. Everyone else has walked right through it as well, don't we? Now the toilets are actually really important. They're about 8 foot deep, so you're looking about as tall as you see them. The top of them had fossilised with the inside hand. They were just as mushy, just as stinky as the day they were done. And all the archaeologists have seen the photos there, they dug through every inch of it. And they found the world's largest fossilised human poo, which is that big. It's an absolute monster. You all have the pleasure of seeing it today, and unfortunately you're also going to smell it. Because instead of me just talking to you about this, we've rebuilt it. When you go around that corner, you get the sights, the sounds, and the smells. All you guys with the face masks, you're going to be fine. Kids, best of luck, you're going to need it. Okay, guys. If you head around that corner, enjoy your visit, everyone. Thank you.
It was a busy place, with people arriving from all over the Viking world to visit, trade and settle. In this multicultural society, people had different appearances, languages, religions and possessions. The remains of part of this thriving city were found right here, and by carefully piecing together all of the archaeological evidence and what we know from other sources, you can now visit the Viking Age.
Come here. Welcome in the Orbe.
You have arrived by the River Foss. Ahead lies the city with countless houses and workshops, many of them newly rebuilt. Some, like this damaged one, a victim of an untended half perhaps. As ships became more seaworthy, the Vikings created wider trading routes, sometimes using chains of middlemen to carry goods from one side of the Viking world to the other. Silks and the cowrie shell found here suggest trade with Central Asia, the Eastern Mediterranean and the Red Sea. It's possible that our trade by this man made their way to Europe to sell it. Slavers may have come to Europe from Dublin or elsewhere, bringing with them the spoils of their raids or packing ventures. Slaves were an important part of society all over Northern and Western Europe at this time. It looks like this slave trader is trying to make his way up to Copperhead. But before we get there, let's have a look at some of the many craftspeople working here in the city. Here's Sigurd. He's using animal bones and antler from deer to make some everyday objects such as cones, comb cases, skates and bone pins. Making a comb from antler could be very time consuming, as the ones found here were made from many pieces riveted together and then decorated. We know that the Vikings liked to keep themselves well groomed, as we found many combs in the excavations, as well as items such as tweezers and even ear scoops. We'll now head away from the river towards the street of Copperhead and meet some more of the people who lived and worked here. Ahead, you can see a simple, single-story building. These older houses were built from posts and rock and had earth floors and thatched roofs. Most of these houses went out of use in the middle of the 10th century when they were replaced by the old plank buildings that we'll talk about later. These early houses were built end on to the streets and had long backyards with rubbish pits in them. It's not likely that they grew much food in the yards, but they probably kept animals there, such as those pigs you can see in the pen by the fence. From the many pig bones we found here, we know that Viking pigs were quite short and had a long